preliminary notes, HBB calls this as a portion which one needs to understand before they start studying the stanzas. HBB says the stanzas, the commentaries in the second volume where this preliminary notes is finding place, HBB says the stanzas, the commentaries in the second volume are also from the same source, the same archaic records. The contents of the first volume are also, as we all know, are from the same archaic source, the Book of Jnana. The second volume of the Secret Doctrine deals with the evolution of mankind. The first one deals with cosmogenesis, the second volume deals with anthropogenesis. Here, HBB talks of three new postulates or propositions. Here, HBB talks about three new postulates or propositions. These postulates may not be in agreement with what the modern science knows or the current religions talk or practice as the dogmas. This is what Madame Blavatsky is commenting before giving the postulates. Number one postulate: the simultaneous evolution of seven human groups. The simultaneous evolution of seven human groups on different places in our globe. This is the first postulate or proposition. Second, the birth of the astral body is before the birth of the physical body. The astral is a model of the physical. This is the second postulate. And the third, that man in this round preceded every mammalian, the anthropoids included in the animal kingdom. Man, in fact, identified animals. This is what the Bible says. This is quoted by Madame Blavatsky. HBB says that the secret doctrine was not the first one or was not alone in saying man or men were born simultaneously on seven divisions of our globe. Hermes, Tehuti, the thrice greatest, talks about seven primeval or the earliest ancient men who evolved from nature. Chaldeans and Kabbalists also talk about several groups of men created by great gods. These gods is small g. Lots of changes have taken place. The sexless became bisexual after going through reincarnations. Some races got destroyed, new races were formed, one race got merged into another. As I said earlier, these teachings are not definitely in consonance with Bible or religion or the modern science. So these three postulates which he has given in the preliminary notes, HBB is very confident that the religion as well as the modern science will not accept this. So these three postulates have been given as the first step. According to Kabbalists, Kabir is the other real name of Adam. According to Kabbalists, Kabir, K-A-B-I-R, is the other real name of Adam. Kabir, whose name was also Adamas in their books, was born from the bosom of the earth. Kabir, whose name was also Adamas, A-D-A-M-A-S, was born from the bosom of the earth. He was one of the ancestors of mankind. He was the archetype male, a typical male, a model of the future man. It is said Jews obtained primitive ideas about how the creation happened, and they got it from Moses. Jews obtained the primitive ideas about creation. They have got it from Moses. Moses got it from Egypt, the works which were available at Egypt. And a compilation of a work, of a book by name Genesis was the basis. We are calling it a book, but those days perhaps this was only a manuscript. So, Jews obtained the primitive ideas about the whole creation from Moses. Moses got it from the works which were available at Egypt. And a compilation, a book which was called Genesis, or a manuscript which was called Genesis, was the basis. The three postulates or teachings given above at least were corroborating with the ancient excavations which were obtained from Babylonia. The three postulates or teachings which have been given above have been corroborated with ancient excavations which have come out of Babylonia. When people excavated from the ruins, they found the three truths which Madam Blavatsky has given in the previous paragraph. The excavations also gave other related accounts and other details which are as follows. 1. That the race which was the first to fall into generation, which came into being, was called the dark race, called Adamu, A-D-A-M-U. Adamus, Adamu. That the race which was the first to fall into generation, which came into being, was called the dark race, called also as Adamu. And Sarku, S-A-R-K-U. This was the name given to another race which was called the light race. One was called the dark race, the other was called the light race. So that the race which was the first to fall into generation, which came into being, was called the dark race, and also called Adamu. And Sarku is the name given to the race which had light. And this race which had this light remained pure for a long time. Then, number two of the teachings which came out of the Babylonian excavations. The Babylonians recognized two principal races at the time of their origin or coming into the generation as human beings. The Babylonians recognized two principal races at the time of their origin into human races. The races of gods preceded these two. So Babylonians recognized two principal races, and the race of God, R-A-C-E, the race of gods preceded these two. So they're in total three. The race of God is the first one, followed by two races, two R-A-C-E-S, which came out to recognize or to denote the origin of man. History says some 10,000 or 12,000 years ago, the present Gobi Desert was a huge sea. History says some 10,000 or 12,000 years ago, the present Gobi Desert was a huge sea. There was a deluge, huge amount of sea water which entered the land, and that drove many persons to the surrounding mountains. Actually, few survived, many died. The two races recognized are as our second and third root races as per Sir H. Rawlinson's opinion. This is what is quoted by Madam Blavatsky. So the first two races, as described by Babylonian excavations, and there was also one race which preceded these two races, the race of God, and some 10,000 or 12,000 years ago, the present Gobi Desert was a huge sea, and there was a deluge, huge amount of seawater that entered the land, and that drove many persons to the surrounding mountains. Few survived actually, and many died. So these two races recognized, they are our second and third root races as per Sir H. Rawlinson, says Madame Blavatsky. Number three, third teaching. There were seven gods. Each created a man or group of men. You link it with the first postulate which HPB has given in the previous page. There were seven gods. Each created a man or group of men. Each god had a quality like nobility, purity, wisdom, compassion, etc. These creations refer to the formation of primordial men or seven groups of men, and their progenitors or parents were called Pitris. Pitris, not to be mistaken as our forefathers, but Pitris who are divine beings. They are called Pitris by Madame Blavatsky. The places or continents on which the four great races lived and died. The places or continents on which the four great races lived and died, we'll find out. The names were many. According to the Hindu Puranic literature, HPB says we have Sweta Dvipa and Mount Meru, Meru Parvata, which is the place of Vishnu. The secret doctrine calls it simply as the land of gods. Though the Hindu literature, Puranic literature says we have Sweta Dvipa, we have also the Mount Meru or Meru Parvata, which is supposed to be the place of Vishnu. The secret doctrine calls that simply as the land of gods. The imperishable sacred land. That was the place where the first race was born. This place is everlasting from the beginning to the end of Manvantara. It is the land where the seed of the future humanity is sown. The land which stretched southwards and also stretched westwards from the North Pole was the seat of the second race. She is talking about four races. The first race was in that land of gods. The second race, the land which stretched southwards and westwards from the North Pole, was the seat of the second race. And the third continent, a third place, is what we propose to call as Lemuria, Lemuria, a place which stretched from Madagascar to Ceylon and Sumatra. It included Africa, Asia, and Indonesia. This continent, which was gigantic, disappeared in the waters of the Pacific Ocean. And only few islands have been left behind on the surface. Majority of the lands have gone under the sea. Atlantis is the fourth continent. Indo-Aryan occultists have named the fifth continent as America, but HPB says it is actually Europe. And some portion of Asia, which along with Europe makes up the fifth continent. Indo-Aryan occultists have named the fifth continent as America, but it is Europe, says Madame Blavatsky, and some portion of Asia and Europe, they make up the fifth continent. The details of the location of the continents is given so that we can follow the evolution of the first to fifth and then our root race. The details of the location of the continents is given so that we can follow the evolution of the first to fifth and then our root race. So, Europe, it is the fifth great continent. The secret doctrine doesn't take into account islands and peninsulas. Islands, you know, surrounded by water on all sides. Peninsula, there is one side is land, other three sides is water. So, Secret doctrine doesn't take into account islands or peninsulas, nor it takes into account the modern, presently existing distribution of land and sea. So secret doctrine doesn't recognize how the world looks or how the land and the sea is presently existing. According to the secret doctrine, the face of the earth, according to secret doctrine, the face of the earth has changed more than once. There were lots of upheavals, lands appearing and lands submerging, which have taken place, changing the face of the earth so many number of times. The last serious change of land occurred 12,000 years ago, says Madame Blavatsky. Talking about man, the biologists of modern days may not actually agree or believe about the nature of the physical man. The physical man was a giant as he then existed 180 lakhs of years ago. He was fit to fight with the gigantic monsters of air, sea, land, like his forefathers fought. Talking about man, the biologists of modern days may not agree or actually believe that the qualities of physical man, how he looked. The physical man was a giant as he then existed 180 lakhs of years ago. He was fit to fight with gigantic monsters of air, sea and land like his forefathers did. So forefathers also were gigantic. So the man 180 lakhs of years ago was gigantic. Forefathers earlier to this were the ethereal prototype. Ethereal means not physical. Forefathers of the previous were the ethereal prototype of Atlanteans. They had no fear that anything could hurt them. They were fearless, gigantic humans. Some ethereal or the previous race, Atlantean race, some who were physically gigantic in proportion. The modern biologists will laugh at the idea of biblical Adam too. The modern biologists will laugh at the idea of the biblical Adam too. And theologists, theologists means people who practice religion, laugh at ancestors who were apes. The theologists will laugh at ancestors who were apes. And they were named as pithecoids, P-I-T-H-E-C-O-I-D-S. This is the term used by Madame Blavatsky. Modern biologists will laugh at the idea of biblical Adam. They don't even trust there was one person, Adam, who was born and then everything came into being. And theologists laugh at ancestors who are apes, who are also called pithecoids, P-I-T-H-E-C-O-I-D-S. So, as such, the modern biologists also can laugh at the fact and may not believe the then existence of a gigantic man in the past. As far as the tenure of geological periods is concerned, now she is talking about geological periods. As far as the tenure of geological periods is concerned, HPB says the learned men of science are all confused, says Madame Blavatsky. She quotes Mr. Kroll, C-R-O-L-L, who said 25 lakh years represent one geological period. Mr. Kroll said 25 lakh years represent one geological period. Another American geologist says it is 15 lakh years, which is a geological period. A geological period is a time scale used by geologists to describe the timing and relationship of events which include man and the development of man on Earth in the geological history. The secret doctrine agrees to this calculation of geological period. 5 million years have passed from the incipient stage, that is, from the beginning stage to the final evolution of man in the fourth root race, which happened on Atlantean continents. Lemuro, Atlantean continents, it happened. So 5 million years have passed from the incipient stage, that is from the beginning stage, to the final evolution of man in the fourth root race, which happened on Lemuro, Atlantean continents. 1 million years it took for the Aryan race to develop as they are in the present state. The great Atlantis was submerged 850,000 years ago. So roughly 15 lakh years is an accepted period as a geological period as proposed by Mr. Kroll and other geologists. But chronologically speaking, the duration of a geological period is of secondary importance, says Madame Blavatsky. Chronologically, whether it is 15 lakh or 25 lakh, so chronologically speaking, the duration of geological period, whether it is 15 lakh years or 25 lakh years, is of secondary importance, says Madame Blavatsky. More important is the appearance and evolution of man. More important point on which naturalists agreed is more relevant. And naturalists all agree the second Hyperborean continent existed 10 million years ago. The naturalists agree the second Hyperborean continent existed 10 million years ago. They also agreed on the existence of the land of eternal sun, where the sun journeyed once in a year and stayed in place for 6 months. 2.6 million years ago, there were abundant number of trees in the Arctic pole. We say it is full of ice, but then 2.6 million years ago, there were abundant number of trees of various species in the Arctic pole, and the trees in North Pole differed from those available on the South Pole. So both the poles had a lot of vegetation. That's what Secret Doctrine is talking about. HPB is asking, who gave information to Greeks about lands where nights were short and days were long? HPB is asking this question. Who gave information to Greeks about lands where nights were short and days were long? Where was that blessed land? Could they locate it? HPB says, Norway or Scandinavian areas are where nights are of shorter length and nights and days are of longer duration. Beyond this Scandinavian area, is the place of land of eternal light and summer. Modern science goes further and suspects that beyond the Arctic pole, there is an existence of sea, which never freezes, and there is a continent which is always green. We say at the pole there is full of ice, but then the modern science suspects that beyond the Arctic pole there is an existence of sea which never freezes, and there is a continent which is always green. The Puranas and the archaic teachings give the same facts through allegories. The Puranas and the archaic teachings give the same facts through allegories. There is a strong probability that people unknown to history lived some 2.6 million years ago. There is a strong probability that people unknown to history doesn't know them, lived some 2.6 million years ago, and the Greenland was actually a tropical land. That concludes the notes of the preliminary notes given by Madame Blavatsky in the second volume.